So what turns that off is the question, maybe.
What turns that off?
Being reasonable. When you're thinking about the circumstances, and when I'm thinking of how to survive, yeah, that's the point. What I have to do to survive.
I have to think of my sentence is I have to function. So I have to function so I cannot be passionate anymore. Because if I'm passionate, I'm not functional, maybe. Or one of these things which is not okay or not allowed or completely off.
Yeah, or not valuable.
Yeah.
Not in line, in alignment with other.
Because it's some people.
Yeah. If you're going in the forest, I mean, the guy who owns the forest will be pissed off. You got his work.
The moment when I take away my possibility of saying no, I'm not being passionate anymore. That's what I realized when we did all the work for getting this practicum together. I came to a point where I thought, I have no chance to say no because nobody would do it, and then this would not happen. And this was the moment where I totally lost my passion for it. And it was just like, I have to do it, I need to do it. And it was hard work, and it was just, I was just burning out by it. And if I could have kept my possibility open, then I can still say no at any time, then this would have not been a problem.
So how did you give away the power to say no?
By thinking about it, that this would not happen if I'm not doing it.
How did you give away your power?
Same. Like being in this configuration, I have to make it work, because if I'm not making it work, it's not going to happen. And I'm my word that it happens.
And I'm what that it happens?
And I'm my word, because I said it's going to happen. But there's no possibility to say no. Say no, I'm not going to do it. Forget it. Mm-hmm. Because if I say no, this practicum might not have been taking place. Maybe.
So that's the point where we do this I am process. Not doing any movement without really wanting it.
Right. So Thomas didn't get that.
Yeah, Thomas didn't get it. I think most of us didn't get that yet. Because I might
say that again.
Even with this I am process, when you go on the floor and you come to that point where you say I am, and then you say it all the time, and from now on, never do anything, never do any movement, never move one muscle unless you want it. Yeah. And then you can't come in that place again, because you when you give your word for something, you want that. Yeah.
I didn't get the last part. That's an important part for you.
Yeah, so when you did this process, and you're at this point that you don't do anything in your life unless you want it, you can't come to that place where you can't say no anymore, because you want that. You want all you do, so that the no disappears.
But isn't it that things change? Like half a year before I say I want that, and after half a year I'm not longer at that place. But I have given my word.
But then you haven't been at this place that you really wanted.
But then it's not your destiny.
Right.
Then it's not my destiny, right.
Yes, now, and you say no to the same thing in half a year, then it can't be your destiny. Then it's not, then the decision in the first place wasn't a yes.
I'm getting a little confused, because it's two things now. You're talking about destiny, and you're talking about like just wishing.
But it's the same thing.
So you're talking about a job, and they're talking about creation.
Okay.
Creation, we create because we love what we create.
Right.
We create only because the only motivation for creating is because we want the results of what we're creating. It's the only thing.
Are you sure?
Yes.
That we want the results.
Huh?
That we want the results.
Yeah.
Because if you're passionate, you don't necessarily see the result.
Yeah. Yeah, you do. You have the vision. And you're going because you have that vision. That's what you want. And it's about what you love. And love is passionate. So, what you're talking about, Klaus, is a job.
Mm-hmm.
I said yes, I signed the contract, I gave my word, you know, but there's no love about it because you're focused on this rather than that. You're focused on the details or the problems or the circumstances rather than creating for the pure ecstatic joy of creating what you love because you want it to exist in the world.
Right.
Just found something out that if that's the truth, then I don't want to be an enrollment director or center manager at all, because I'm just doing it because I want to be a trainer and I think this is what I need to do in order to get trainings. So that's why I'm always fighting with my nose about all this stuff, because that's not my destiny. My destiny is not being a center manager or enrollment director. My destiny is to be a trainer.
It's for me, when I said yesterday, I don't want to be a center manager, everybody said, I don't believe that. For me, it was like, it's not okay to say I don't want that.
No, wasn't it? No, you said you wanted to be separate and do something on your own, separate from Katrine. That was what it was.
And it's the thing, I don't want to be center manager.
No, we didn't hear that. You didn't say that.
Yeah. You did before we came to reach out.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, but you meshed it in with your thing.
Yeah, you
meshed
it in.
There was no clarity about that. This was meshed in with your all the psychological stuff that you had in common.
So, I have another thing, so I think when we are on the way, We are not at this place where we all want to be. So, I'm sure we have to go through situations where the no's are coming up and go further, also with the no's, just to make this experience. I think it's not possible to make this I am process one time and then everything is easy, everything is passionate. I think we have to work on that. And I think that's, we're all in a place where we have several areas where we really have to work through. And maybe that's what I said to you, just your statement. Learn humbleness and to try to learn from Katrin. That's the only thing, because sometimes we are on a place where we just have to go through.
Yeah.
We need the matrix.
So sometimes for me, when I did the process I am, and you know, I woke up to this world, don't ever do a thing that you don't want to do. And for me, it's like, it's almost, I'm not capable of doing it, because I realized the Neue Linie enrollment thing, my doing the enrollment thing is because I want the money. And it's not that I'm compassionate about it. I mean, I'm compassionate about translation. I'm passionate about translation, but not about enrolling people.
It's all obvious. I mean, have you created any enrollments?
No.
So, stop it. The thing is, like, when are you going to be willing to say no about that?
Yeah, so far I've been saying it by, you know, somehow fucking it up.
Mm-hmm.
Not by saying no, I'm not, that's not my thing. It's true.
So then you force me to say no to you.
Yeah.
You force me to go, Constantine, man, this is not working, it's over. And then you can blame me or whatever you want, pretend like I don't like you or whatever. But the truth is that this is something you created.
Yeah, it's because I didn't own, no.
What you're not really owning is what yes is.
What yes is.
And you're not owning what the yes is for you. And right. Being that.
You can't do what you own the no.
Huh?
You can't unless you own the no. Isn't it that?
No, I think you have to own the yes first, and then you can tell what the no is about.
Okay.
If I get that it's okay for me to be my destiny alive in action. If I get that, then I go, hey, leave me alone. That's not it. that's not it, this is it, that's what I'm going for. No, just forget it, you know, that's it, and then go. And it's the yes, and then the no's become real clear.
But on the other hand, I have the experience when I cut off this possibility, I say no.
It's not cut off.
Yeah, it's not, but it's sometimes, you know, sometimes I'm doing it, I cut it off, so I can't do it, I have to. Yeah. Support the center in Freiburg, so maybe no event will happen. So, you know, when I cut off this no, the possibility, so I can't really say yes.
That's called the responsible victim.
Right. I know it by that, you know. I really remember what Jim Sarris did in Frankfurt, you know.
Yeah.
You don't forget it.
Okay, it's like it seems that I can say yes to something and be passionate, but then comes another block, and that's my psychology. It's not that it's not my destiny. So I'm mixed up with. I don't think that I'm so perfect that I don't have any psychological blocks who are in my way from my destiny. So I can step into the direction of my destinies, and no's are coming, but that are not no's because it's not my destiny, that are no's because it's my psychology. And what we all said here in the room, or what I heard till now, was if you know your destiny, there's no more blocks, and you just have your yes. And I didn't get that.
I don't think that this is necessarily true, that there are no blocks. Underneath the block is still the passion. I mean, I can feel it when I'm with my passion. I still have blocks, but the blocks are not bigger than me. There are blocks and there are resistances, but I don't know if I can explain it very well, but it's like I know there's something underneath all of it, and I can still pass through.
It's like for me, you know, the experience I was giving when I was telling about the guy, about the plaster, you know, story I told in America, when he said no to me. So, at my one of the building sites, so this guy was saying to me, it's not working. So that was a no, it was a block. And kind of for me, it feels like when we are passionate and we are focused on our goal, so that the no's are kind of, we are able to let the no's in, like destroy the space of the no, and the space of the no is kind of eaten, resolved, kind of, it's resolved to my good, aufgelöst. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's resolved with our big yes, with the passion we have inside, and we can go further. So it's not like, you know, coming to a block and saying, oh, it's not working, and you stop. It's like, yeah, let it in, okay. And you go on to the next step. Like Aikido was in my talk yesterday saying, it feels like Aikido, you know, taking this energy, you know, fill your own body with the energy and give it away again. Next step. Do you still have that number from the hotel before we used to get it?
Yes. It's the 50 number.
No. It is true that if we own our power of creation, then there is nothing that we do that we don't want to do. If we own the tremendous creation of force that we are just recreating everything. We're creating every single aspect about our lives. And we're even then creating ourselves as a victim. We are, everything about what we do is created. We create it. We create every thought, every feeling, every action, the energy that we put out, every place we put our attention, every interaction, every consideration. So we're creating all of this about ourselves. If we own that, then you have to look at the fact that every move you make or we make that is not what we think we want to do is still a creation of ours. So we're creating ourselves being a victim.
So if, as long as you not follow that we are not aware that everything created, we're just a victim of what's going to happen.
So you sit there. You sit like that. You don't move anything. You don't create anything from now on for the rest of your life unless you choose to consciously and you want to.
Okay.
Okay. We already said this to you yesterday.
2 days ago.
2 days ago. Okay. So that's always an option for us. I didn't have to tell that to you for that to have been true. That was always true for us. After we're adults, you know, after we're not, you know, in our families with our parents, doing what our parents tell us to do. I mean, even then, we do it to survive. We survive. We chose to survive by putting on the mask, giving away our power, being quiet, all that. So now we have the choice to take that all back. Every move we make is because we want to. If we don't know that, if we don't act on that, if we create ourselves as victims and disempowered and everything's a burden, everything's a problem, we're still doing that.
What I'm hearing is, what I have this clear in this distinction, I'm saying that if we don't do this, then we are victims. Is this what you're saying?
No, I'm saying we can create ourselves as
a
victim, victims.
And this is a choice.
Yes.
Okay.
Right.
And we can't create ourselves as victims anymore. We are aware of that. Every move I do is my own choice.
Yeah. Say the first part. Say the first part.
So that it's not the possibility of being a victim. That I choose. Every move I do is conscious.
Yeah, when you realize the power of you as a creator, Uta the creator, is Uta creates everything about Uta.
Right.
Every interpretation that you have about anything that anybody else does, what you hear, the meaning that you give, everything is all created by Uta. Mm-hmm. So you can create, if you own that power, then anytime you're a victim, you created it.
So we're basically functioning on two levels. One level is that you always have a yes for everything, even if you create yourself as a victim. Because you do it, and the moment you do it, you have a yes. The other level is that you create no's. You know what I mean?
No. I mean, I believe you. I mean, if that works for you, it's fine. I'm not there.
I just had the idea. If we are the ones who are creating everything in our life.
Talk about you personally.
If I'm the one who's creating everything in my life.
Yes. For example, this practicum.
For example, this practicum.
Right.
Then my first core commitment is a yes. Because I do it.
Right.
Although I have all those resistances and all these no's who are coming up. But the no's, I'm creating myself also.
Yeah.
So basically, in the beginning there's this yes. From the yes, I create all kinds of like no's, yes, maybe, whatever.
Mm-hmm. I mean, if you want to get down into, what's it called, non-duality? If you want to get into non-duality, then all there is yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Creation is yes.
All there is yes.
Okay. The only thing that exists is yes, because creation is yes. And there is no no, if you're going to be non-dual about it. But if you're going to sign your name on a contract that says you're going to do a job, which means to deliver a practicum by a certain day in a way that's impeccable, and then you feel a victim to that you have to do it now, and there's no possibility of saying no, so fuck it, I'm not going to do it, you're creating the whole thing.
Right.
And, you know, we're not looking at the hidden costs of the no's. Like, is it okay if I'm using you for an example about this thing, about the practicum?
Yeah.
Just because, you know, you're not looking at what the cost of the no is for you, and for everybody in camp, and for the entire world, and for the future of humanity. Like, you're not looking at what the cost is. You're just looking at the fact that, oh, I have to make phone calls and handle details, all these fucking details, and I have to, you know, do all this, I have to do all that, and that's, like, too expensive for me. So it's cheaper for me to just go to America and let Uta and Volker, like, handle it without even making an agreement about it, and just sort of, like, well, I'm not doing it, because I'm busy, I'm doing something else, and if you know, you do it. You want to do it, you do it. Whatever, and I'm not going to do it. And so that's cheaper for you. It's less expensive than actually doing it. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So that's the surface cost, but the hidden costs of that. You understand what I mean by hidden costs? Yeah. It's like a nuclear power plant. Look, free nuclear power. You throw 10 kilos of plutonium into a thing, man, that fucker like lights up the city, you know? This is free power, man. This is like cheap, free power. So that's what it looks like on the surface. But the hidden cost is 50,000 years of a radioactive core that can't be just gotten rid of anywhere. And the possibility of meltdown and explosion and contaminating the water, contaminating life, and killing the whole population on the Earth. That's the real cost. The hidden cost, yeah. So we don't see the hidden cost of our nose. What if you really saw the hidden cost of your no, what would be obvious?
The psychological strategy, hidden purpose.
Well, yeah, and what would be the obvious if you could see the hidden cost of your no, what would be clear to you?
That I'm wasting opportunities.
If I would be really aware of the hidden costs, I would not do it because it's way too expensive.
What are the hidden costs?
Relationship, joy, passion.
What do you mean in terms of the practicum? At all?
Can you be specific about the practicum?
Yeah, and for the practicum also.
What were the hidden costs?
It cost me joy, it cost me relationship, it cost me the feeling of my own strengths and all of that.
But that is not the hidden cost. That's your cost. But
no, that's the hidden. He didn't see that before.
Relationship, for example.
He didn't see what it cost him in his relationship to you.
And to the
whole camp community.
You throw a plutonium in the whole city, explodes, you know.
Yeah.
Because I think this was a kind of mood which went over, all the campers. You
know? Yeah.
Nobody was really inspired by the practice.
For the last year or whatever.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah.
No cook has been found or something.
Right.
No what?
No cook, you didn't find a cook, you were good.
I had three, but they all canceled.
Yeah.
So you didn't find one.
Right.
And perhaps what he's saying is maybe they canceled. What Volker's saying is they canceled because you canceled first.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, probably. That's a hidden quality. That's really the, like a chain reaction.
Mm-hmm. It's always, I mean, when I'm going into our team meeting, a woman team meeting,
mm-hmm.
and I'm totally, don't really want to be there, nothing is going to happen.
Right.
Nothing is going to happen. And if I mean, and I have been there many times, I'm totally inspired, I was totally on fire, and the whole moment team was just exploding.
Mm-hmm.
Right. It was really obvious because we had many ideas, for example, about the talks, but we then had to join this enrollment team just to start it. You know, the ideas were there, but nobody started it. And this was very obvious. And when you came, the thing changed. Until we got the burnout. And then it stopped again. It looked absolutely obvious.
And you got the burnout because...
Yeah, I don't know if I blame something with that, because I got the burnout because I thought there's anything going wrong in this ethanol, you know? It's not clear what's the direction. You know, it was like there was no leadership for me.
Mm-hmm.
So I had no, you know, the idea of the whole thing. I'm not the vision holder for ethanol. So the vision for ethanol was not present for me, really. I'm a part of it. But not the whole thing. It was like, yeah, it's like I missed the direction of the whole thing and the clarity.
Mm-hmm.
And this was because of you, of course, because of Corona, was the thing where I wrote in the letter. I think it was like just, yeah, like there was no leadership.
Yeah.
And it's not that I put away my responsibility, because I didn't leave my leadership in Freiburg as well. So, but I think it's all... We are all connected together, and one node of one of the community is like a chain reaction going through.
Well, especially from a leader.
Especially from a leader, yeah, that's what I mean.
So yeah, leadership now sets up no and everybody below. Mm-hmm. So theoretically, would it have been possible? Here's what I'm getting, and this blows me away. This is the secret for how one human being can change the world. Okay. From your position down there in Freiburg, seeing that there was no leadership and that above you was a no and above you was chaos, could you have been a yes that was big enough to own? I mean, this is actually what happened, but it wasn't fully. Like, could you have been big enough, you and Uta, for example, could you have been a big enough yes to own the camp community and make the practical happen? Okay. So it's really what you did.
Yeah, but no.
Until you got to your no.
Right. Yeah, that's true.
But I'm talking theoretically.
Theoretically, would have been possible, of course. Just to say there's nobody working it, we're jumping in, we're doing it.
So
and inspiring people and say, wait, this would be a great practice. And we talked with Kirsten at the phone with Christine and us. We got this letter from Bernard and Heike, and so this would have. We could have done that, yes.
Right, so for you to do that, what would the shift have to have been for you?
Yeah, not playing victim one, and that what happened.
Right, and the other side, that's the negative side. What's the positive side of the shift that would have had to happen?
It just be in contact with my vision about ethno, about the world, about my destiny.
Right, and then who are you in relationship to camp community in Europe, then?
The leader.
Yeah, you're it. At source, then you are at source for the Athanor community in Europe. Now, could anybody in the Athanor community have done that?
Yes.
Yeah. Anybody could have said, it's not happening, I'm it. Right. I'm making it happen.
In fact, it's a big possibility. I didn't see that yet.
Could you look at Athanor Europe and say, it's not happening. It's clearly not happening. I have a vision for how it could happen, and I'm it for Athanor Europe.
Yeah.
Could you do that?
Yes, I could.
Yeah. Did Bernard do that?
Yeah, he actually did it. That's right.
That's what he just did.
Yeah.
So, where's the limit to that?
There's no limit.
Could you own the world?
Yes.
that's how one human being changes, you know, humanity, makes a difference in the world. One human being, by becoming it at that level. And yes, at that level, source at that level. That's the game we're in here. That's what this game is.
It's interesting because I have reference points for that. You know? That's how I get the leadership position in my place where I work.
Mm-hmm. But then you hit the fog, like, you know. For me, that's what it's like. Like, I'm just beginning to see through the layer of fog where I am,
yeah,
you know, where I was last year. Now I'm at the fog where I am now. Like, I can't quite see through the fog for the... And it's clear, I mean, it's like there's like this, you know... If I could see through this fog, it's big, you know, and then there's fog after that, and you just keep like, I mean, that's just my present experience about the fog thing. It's just like being it at the level that I can be it.
It's just an interesting thing for me. It's what stops me doing it is this kind of no to, you know, this official position. So, for example, at my place where I work, I was we had this middle leading level and this high leading level, and the high leading level didn't work at all. And a friend of mine and we were really holding the space. I know that now, I didn't know that till that time because I had no idea about holding space theoretically.
Mm-hmm.
But we did for a long time because our boss and the second boss had a very bad reputation, so we did the whole what's it called, public relation, and we were holding the space, and I stopped that time because I thought, yeah, I'm not getting the money for it. Mm-hmm. They're getting the money and I'm doing the work, and this was exactly the same thing now. You know, I said I'm not getting the money, he's getting the money, or guys, and I'm doing the work. That's the same I said yesterday about Gerhard. He's getting the money, I'm doing the work.
Yeah, and they love it.
Yeah, and that's my question. You know, when I really step in and take over and be it, so how can I get the money for it? Or how can I get...
How can you?
How can I, yes. That's the question.
How can you?
Yeah, how can I? Just... Yeah, go into Porna, say that that's what I did, and I'm doing it. I need the money.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So you see the same thing to me too, what can. Because I knew I could easily have handled the whole practicum.
Yep.
I have handled all the practicums in the States,
mm-hmm,
no problem. I was going, I'm not doing all this work next to the work I have and not getting paid for it.
Right. So make the extra move. Get the money for it. Don't say no because you're not getting the money. Get the money.
Right. For me, it's not always about money. It's sometimes about having someone who says thank you or who appreciate what I'm doing.
Cash is pretty important.
Yeah, of course, but cash.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not only. I don't want to say that it's not cash, but it's not only the cash.
No, you're right. Yeah.
How come you're white?
Yeah, that's the question.
Yeah, because I don't move for that. I don't move for that. Yeah.
My question
is... Du meinst, ich habe nicht das gemacht, was Udi jetzt machen kann, aber vorne. Aber ich glaube, du meinst es anders. Du meinst...
Can you speak English?
Yeah, it's difficult. You mean that
you just told me I don't want cash. You just told everyone I don't need fucking cash. I don't want that dirty money. That's what you just said in the essence. So my question was, how come you're saying this?
Because I'm not worth it for that. I'm not worth the money. I'm worth for the thank you, but not for more.
Oh, thank you.
And that's the same thing that came up for me when you yesterday said, well, you all can do the camp enrollment with me on the team. I was like, sure I can, but I want to get paid for it.
So why didn't you say that?
I didn't. I thought this is, I don't know. I just didn't click in me. I just thought I can't do that because I don't know.
I don't understand that. For me, it's like if I'm serving, I don't have to take money for that.
Well, the thing is, you don't take money, okay? And therefore, you're saying no.
Yeah.
So you keep your game going and saying no. If you would take the money, you wouldn't have a reason to say no, because then you can say, well, this is what I want to do. This is what you owe me, give me the money for. The no would disappear. Your no would disappear immediately. If you would own the money for what you're working for, then your no would disappear.
That's right, that's exactly right. And I think that for years I had this idea, you know, I'm very precious, you know, doing all this stuff, not taking money for it. And that's right, it's true, because to any point I could say no, because I didn't get the money for it. No, I think it was kind of keeping the no present, because I'm not really getting the money for it.
I do the same thing.
Yeah. It's very interesting.
That's actually the only thing I need to work on, because I can say yes to everything and ask more. I can actually do every job almost. I mean, I would probably do what we're doing. I could send a management and program director, whatever, if I had the cash back. And I'm just saying no because it's not what I have created for myself.
So you're getting some clarity about that?
Oh, yeah, and I don't need to clarify more about what the jobs are. I need to clarify about where's the cash coming.
For me, it's like I'm resigned with that. So I see Ethno has no mind. We put all the numbers out yesterday, and it was like, yeah, so I can go and look for money, but there is no one, so how can I get that?
So you're a victim of circumstances.
So you know what I did? I created Camp 2. There was no money for me in Athenor. And I wanted to make money in Athenor. So I created New Line Europe, corporate businesses in Europe, corporate trainings in Europe. So it's just what Uta's saying. It's like a shift. It's a shift. So I want to do this. I want to do that. So how? How do I do it? What makes it work for me? How do I make it work for everybody? How do I make it work for everybody? Instead of going, well, you know, it's not enough for me, so forget it, can't do it. It's about creation rather than circumstances. You know, you look at all the circumstances, like it's like you're looking for life rather than creating your life. You're going around looking for possibilities instead of creating possibilities. Well, how are you doing the same?
Well, in terms of I'm looking for possibilities, you know. I've had, for instance, this idea of writing a book. I carry this with me for 20 years or something like that. And also the theater thing and the music, it's always been there. So and I've been waiting to been giving a chance to open it up, you know, but I didn't create a chance to use that or to develop that.
Most people in the world go around looking for possibilities instead of creating possibilities. And we're designed to create possibilities. An adult human being is designed to interface with the universe in a way that we can create possibilities. Every time we create a possibility, we're actually creating a new universe. I don't know if I said that before here, but when Purna created Camp, Camp did not exist before. He looked at the situation and created the possibility for Camp. When we make a creation is a universe in which people can live. That's what a creation is. So Constantine's book that he created yesterday was, you go in the book and there, all of a sudden there's characters, there's funny little rules, you know, some of them speak, some of them are glasses, some of them only, like, the snake can't talk, it still hisses, right? So, but
the pig can talk. But they all talk, actually.
Okay, so, anyway, but, like, it's like you can live in the universe that Constantine created in the little story. You know, it's 25 sentences or something, but it's like a whole universe that you can live in. And that's what Camp 2 is. Camp 2 is a universe that I created because I wanted to live there. And I wanted to live there with other people. So I love this. So this is, I wanted this to exist. That's why I created it. And, you know, I get some money from it. It's not enough money for me to live on, so I'm creating some other stuff. And I'm not trying to, like, say, you know, how great I am, because I'm struggling with all this stuff. I am, like, we are at the edge of what I know. And I'm still asleep half the time about it, you know, and I still blocks, and there's still the fog, and I still struggle. But anyway, I'm looking, you know, we're building another foundation to take off from here, to go to the next step. When Camp 2 is solid, like Camp 2 landed in the world in the last couple of weeks. Camp 2 has finally gotten in people's bodies, like, and I'm telling you, it's like barely here. It landed in America. Here, we're just, you guys don't really, like, it's not it yet. But I'm telling you, it landed in the world, and I'm certain of it, because I've seen it. So when Camp 2's landed in the world, then we can stand on that as a platform and go to the next place. And I want to go to the next place. I'm getting some ideas about what the next place is, and it's very interesting. So I'm really wanting this to land as a universe that we can live in. And it has to do with you creating possibilities instead of looking for possibilities. And if we had a group of people who were working together in the world, functioning, creating possibilities for ourselves and others, that's huge. And then we go from there.
I think the interesting thing for me is that there's a connection between my destiny and making money. I haven't seen that yet.
There
has to be.
You cannot have a viable destiny unless there's cash flow.
But you know, what I did was doing my job. I think the job fits also in my destiny, but only with a small part. I did my job, you know, get the money there, and working for my destiny in the time off. You know, and this is still the thing in my life, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I got that my destiny has to make money. So I have to make money through my destiny. So then I have the whole energy and the whole space living my destiny.
So there's a piece. Go ahead.
I would like to ask you, is this true?
It's true.
Like I'm working my destiny. Well, okay, we have a lot of making money. So it doesn't necessarily have to be true what you were saying.
What are you saying?
Well, I'm saying so far, back in the past, the same thing, but it's still a yes, you know. And making the cash with the other companies.
It's your destiny.